Hello, I'm Judy Gay. I'm the Vice President for Academic Affairs at Community College of Philadelphia. Today I'm going to be interviewing Dr. Dennis McGrath. Dr. McGrath is Professor of Sociology at Community College, and he also is a well-known evaluator and researcher in sociology. He's been involved with a number of large-scale preschool to baccalaureate projects looking at educational reform. He's also the author or editor of four books, and he is an award-winning teacher on the community college faculty. I should mention that he has his bachelor's degree from LaSalle University, a Philadelphia institution, and his master's and Ph.D. from the New School of Social Research. So thank you for coming in to talk to me today.
You're very welcome.
Now, you've spent a lot of your career working on, as I mentioned, these large-scale educational reform efforts. So before we talk about what you've found, can you say a little bit about what got you interested and involved in educational reform?
Well, actually, like most things in my life, it was completely unplanned. In graduate school, my area of focus was urban studies and urban economic development, and I had expected to be doing that. And after graduate school, I was doing research in that area. I was a consultant to Philadelphia City Council on economic development issues. But teaching here, I became increasingly engaged with our students and particularly interested in issues of transfer, which means students who begin here at the community college but want to transfer to a four-year college or university to get their baccalaureate degree. Mm-hmm. And I was involved in creating two programs for transfer-oriented students. One is the college's interdisciplinary honors program that we started through a grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities, and then another program called the Transfer Opportunities Program that was funded by the Ford Foundation. And through that, I got to know Ford Foundation program officers, and they began hiring me to do evaluation research, which means studying programs that they fund to see their effectiveness. And then I began being hired by other national foundations to do both evaluation research and consulting on educational reform projects.
So a perfect blending of your interests eventually and opportunities.
Absolutely.
That led to a very important topic, particularly now, educational reform. You mentioned the Ford Foundation. Your last book dealt with looking at an initiative that they had over 10 years.
Yes.
In 16 cities, looking at preschool through the baccalaureate level of education and some things that were learned through that large-scale study. Could you talk a little bit about that, what you learned from that?
Oh, absolutely. That assignment probably had the biggest impact both on my life and my thinking. And the background is that this program, which was called the Urban Partnership Program, was meant to be a new form of grant making by the Ford Foundation. And the real difference is typically foundations only fund projects for 2 or 3 years, which is understandable on their part. They have a lot of different interests, but not really enough time to make very significant change, certainly in education. So they decided that they were going to make a long-term commitment to a number of projects, and that they would guarantee 10 years of funding. Yeah. if the local initiatives met mutually agreed upon benchmarks. Mm-hmm. And what was also distinctive is this was one of the first projects that's called a P16 educational reform effort. And roughly what that means is taking a systematic look at what happens with students from preschool and early education, which is the P and P16,
right,
through to the baccalaureate degree, which is the grade 16, and often beyond toward graduate or professional school. And so Ford followed the typical model of this. And they invited 16 cities from around the country, from very large New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, to medium-sized cities like Minneapolis and Seattle, to smaller ones like Rochester and Memphis, to apply. And in order to get the grant, they had to agree to bring together leaders and members of all the major institutions of the city. The school district, community colleges, four-year colleges and universities, local government, business, social agencies, nonprofit organizations, and parents, and to come together and look at data on what's happening with young people in their city from preschool through the baccalaureate. Mm. So in P16 reform, the metaphor that's used is the notion of a pipeline, mm-hmm. that youngsters enter the pipeline at preschool, and then to see what happens all the way through. So I was brought in about 4.5 years into the 10-year initiative. And Ford had engaged another researcher to look at student outcomes, what was happening to students in terms of grades and academic progress. But the members of the local P16 teams were complaining that nobody was looking at the real heavy lifting, because a P16 council typically brings together institutions that don't normally talk to each other to try to engage and think about what can be done for the students as they move along educational level. So I was hired.
By heavy lifting, you mean just the working together.
Talking,
cooperating. okay.
Yes, talking, cooperating, okay. Collaborating. Okay. So I was engaged to be the director of qualitative research. And I hired a research team. I had a local researcher in each of the 16 cities. And I hired an associate director to help me begin looking at what you would call the collaboration process, how mm-hmm. these institutions come together. And then also, the Ford Foundation had a long time commitment in South Africa, so they began a sister initiative in three sites in South Africa, and I was engaged to also work on the evaluation of those, which got me looking at educational issues in South Africa as well. So I guess, long story short, a P16 approach to educational reform is distinctive because, on the one hand, it tries to take a systematic look at what's happening to young people through the whole arc of their educational careers,
including the leaks.
In
the pipeline.
That's right.
Who's dropping out when in the pipeline and why, maybe?
Yes. Well, actually, what's really, really striking is when communities began assembling data on what's happening to young people in their cities, what we found was almost all student problems, academic problems, dropout, behavior problems, clustered at the transition points, beginning preschool to kindergarten or first grade, elementary to middle school, middle to high school to community college to university. And what that told us is that institutions typically function as the metaphor is silos, mm-hmm. as standalone institutions. Everybody has their own mission,
right.
their own concern, yet most of the student problems cluster at the transition points where nobody is really responsible. Mm. So one of the most important things that a P16 approach can take is to get everybody, all leaders of all the institutions, looking at these data, and then begin strategizing what can be done to help and support students and ease their movement, really create pathways for them all along the educational process. So give you a very quick sense. The typical low-income student in the United States begins school 18 months behind affluent students in school readiness skills, mm-hmm. and they fall further behind every... every single year of education. We also discovered that children from low-income, from high-income families are 8 times more likely to attend and graduate from college than children from low-income families. We also discovered some of the key transition points. So for instance, reading on grade in the third grade turns out to be one of the best predictors of whether a youngster will attend or graduate from college.
Oh, really?
And this was
so
really
striking. So you can tell as early as third grade.
If you only had one variable, that would really be one of the very best ones. And the reason is, in the United States, typically the third grade is the last year that reading is taught directly. Yet every subject requires reading skills. So students with weak reading abilities tend to fall further and further behind. Another transition that we discovered that was critical is that for mathematics education, the key is taking algebra in the eighth grade, because algebra is the gateway course to more advanced mathematics and college level math. And yet, when you look at what's happening across the country, fewer than 30% of low-income students are taking algebra in the eighth grade. So we were helping school districts look at, you know, what needs to be done in these areas.
Almost how we might be setting some students up for failure by not having certain kinds of opportunities. Or recently there's been some conversation about social promotion, moving students forward, even if they're not meeting certain standards or competencies. So if they're poor readers in third grade, just promoting them to fourth grade just so to promote them isn't necessarily going to be a strategy for success in terms of students.
Absolutely, and every big school district struggles with what do you do with students with weak academic skills, because holding them, the old practice of holding them back in grade is not very effective.
It's also not working either.
It's also not working. So really, one of the really important things that comes out of a P16 reform approach is that you have a lot of different people looking at the same data and trying to come up with solutions. So give you an example, in some of the more successful Ford cities, when people would see this problem of needing to raise the reading and the math abilities of students, they began to strategize all kinds of very powerful and successful supplemental approaches. So just as one example, one of the very best P16 reform efforts is in Santa Ana, California. And Santa Ana is a very interesting city because it's in the heart of very wealthy Orange County and is surrounded by some of the wealthiest counties in the suburbs in the United States. And yet, it's one of the poorest of American cities, and it's the second greatest Spanish-speaking city in the United States after Laredo, Texas, because it receives a lot of Mexican-American immigrants to it. And they have a wonderful collaborative that involves the Santa Ana School District, the Community College District, Santa Ana Community College. There's the University of California campus, UC Irvine, right there, and there's also a California State University site, and they've come together with local government to try to work together and identify and solve problems that they were having with their students, that their students were having. And one of the most significant things they did was they created these faculty discipline teams in English, and literature studies, mathematics, social studies, science, which included faculty from the middle schools, the high schools, the community colleges, and the universities. And they began looking together at what were the challenges that their students were facing, what would be creative solutions. One of the very nice things that they did was they created a Saturday math academy, which was staffed jointly by middle school, high school, and community college, university faculty who worked together to develop the curriculum. And they tremendously raised the mathematics ability of the students. Then together they began looking and asking the question, why are they more successful on Saturday than Monday to Friday? And that engaged school district administrators in looking at the entire math program and introducing some of the mathematics teaching practices that were being used in the Saturday Academy into the regular classes. And the culmination of that was that the school district board finally passed a resolution requiring that all students in Santa Ana will take algebra in the eighth grade to be able to enter a college prep curriculum in high school. And this is starting to happen around the country, but there was a lot of debate, there was a lot of worry, what happens to the weaker students, will we be forcing students out of school? And it's been a wonderful success because they put a lot of effort into preparing the teachers, professional development, support for the students. And when I talked to the director of the collaborative, who's also a vice president at Santa Ana Community College, she actually cried and she said, this tells me all the generations of previous students that we in effect abandoned. Because now we can see that if we work together and bring all the institutions and resources together, we can help students succeed. And we're starting to see more of this requirement of algebra, you know, around the country.
So getting together people who initially might think of their charge, their mission, as a certain grade level, to come together around a common problem. Students are not acquiring the math skills that will take them all the way through the pipeline. And having them all talk about what might be an appropriate strategy, when should you be introducing what concepts and how to children, and how does that take you to the next level? Because now you're talking to the teachers who are going to be working with the students at the next level, help to shape a program that turned out to be very effective. That conversation across different levels of education around a common problem seemed to be really working.
Absolutely, and the shorthand term for this is called thinking P-16. So the more people become involved in P-16 reform, the less they exclusively think in terms of the issues of their institution, and the more they begin thinking about what's the arc of the student's experience, what's our part in it, how can we work with our partners, and you get some very powerful ideas and innovations out of that because people are beginning to think and work and collaborate in ways that they never did before.
One of the things that you said that's particularly interesting to me is that everybody talks today about taking everything to scale. If something's working, take it to scale, which seems easier said than done. But it sounds like in this case, they did take a program that was developed that worked on Saturday, and then they started to expand, well, how do we get this to work during the week, and then how does it work in other institutions? So they actually did take something to scale. What happened that made it possible to go from keeping it just a Saturday program to making it something that was infused throughout the things that were being taught in the city?
Well, that is a great question because bringing reform to scale is absolutely the biggest challenge that we have in education reform. And I guess the way I would put it is, we know how to create a good classroom, academically powerful, good teaching, good curriculum classroom. We know how to create a good school. We know how to create a small network of schools, but nobody has brought reform to scale in an entire district in a sustained way yet. And yet that's what has to be done. I mean, one way of, without that, you have a series of just special programs that serve 30, 40, 50 students. one of the great collaborative leaders that I got to meet has a way of putting it. The problem with a special program is if you don't go to school on Tuesday, you can't go to college because you don't get enrolled, you miss it, your sister's in the program, you're not in the program. We have to find ways to scale things up. And as a evaluation researcher and a consultant, I'm always looking at this issue and trying to think of solutions to that problem. And a P16 reform effort is a very useful way to do it, because at the local level, it rests on what are typically called P16 councils, which again are representatives from every major institution and every level of education in the community. And one of the key practices they have is looking together at common data so that everybody understands what the educational problems and challenges are. And also, when there's a successful program, reviewing it, analyzing it, reverse engineering it, trying to understand why is this program successful and what can we learn from it? What kinds of practices or structures could we take and potentially scale up to larger numbers of students? And I think this joint review of both problems and successes is critical to the scaling up effort, because even the best-willed school district can't do it on its own. It needs external support and partners, and it also has to have very good data about, you know, what's working and what's not working to guide the best decisions about reform efforts.
Now, you mentioned how these multiple, I guess, stakeholders did come together. They used data to help drive decisions. They studied exemplary programs. But a friend of mine talked about how difficult it is to get giants to dance. You know, you've got these silos, you've got people who are decision makers in their own regard. How do you get them to come together and make a collaboratively reached decision, as opposed to feeling like, well, I should be in charge. I should be the one that's calling the shots. We're the leaders of the elementary schools. We should be calling the shots.
Yes.
We're the leaders of the college. We know more. How do you get people past their own, thoughts about who should be making the final decision to come to a collaborative decision?
That is a real bear of a problem. Because again, as you say, people are much more familiar and skilled with institutional leadership than collaborative leadership.
Right.
And collaborative leadership is a very, very different style. The Ford Foundation in their Urban Partnership Program were very, very smart that one of their criteria for choosing which city they were going to support was whether there was what they called a local champion, an institutional leader who was open to collaboration and willing to pull others in. Because one of the keys is not needing to always take credit for your
success,
for your institution and your success. And they were able to find institutional champions in each of those cities. And in my research and working with other collaboratives, that seems to be the key, that there's one or more local institutional leaders who thinks collaboratively, who sees the need for it and is willing to reach out to others. So for instance, in Santa Ana, you've had really, really close working relationships among the school district superintendent and the chancellor of the community college district. At UC Irvine, the key has been the vice chancellor for student services and then the president at the state university. And one of the things that they've agreed on is whenever there's a turnover in leadership and somebody leaves, a new person comes on, the other three start working them
right
from
away.
Day one to bring them in, to explain what's going on, to involve them, and they've been very, very successful with that. I mean, another example, in the past 3.5 years, I've been working in the state of Ohio for the Knowledge Works Foundation, which is the leading foundation in the state for educational reform issues. And I've been working with them on a statewide P16 reform effort. And as part of that, I mean, I've partly been working on state issues, state policy issues with them. But I've also been working with this very, very large P16 reform effort that they've started in the greater Cincinnati area. And it's really a cast of thousands because it includes the city of Cincinnati, the surrounding suburbs, and portions of northern Kentucky on the other side of the Ohio River. Mm-hmm. So it's four school districts, a cast of thousands, mm-hmm. and so on. But the president of the board is Nancy Zimpfer, who is the president of the University of Cincinnati, who has actually written books on collaboration and is committed to it. And she has reached out to the other university and community college leaders, the superintendent of the schools, the head of the United Way is deeply mm-hmm. involved, the head of the chamber of commerce. But you have to have, as you said, absolutely leadership that's oriented toward collaboration. Mm-hmm. And the other piece of collaborative leadership is as P16 reform efforts continue, everybody who's drawn into it starts to think in a more collaborative way. Mm. And the way it's been described to me as I would interview people is that people, when people think about their institutional role, whether it's as a dean or an administrator or a counselor or a teacher, they're also thinking about ways to partner and collaborate with people at other institutions so that you find collaborative leadership is happening at every level of the institutions.
So having some experience with it, it just becomes a part of your way of thinking. Who else do to reach out to? Who else
Absolutely.
Do I bring into this conversation? How do we get this done? What other stakeholders
that
need to
that
be involved?
That starts to become the way that people work, okay. as opposed to doing it alone. I mean, one quick example, since I was thinking about Santa Ana, every one of the higher ed institutions, of course, is interested in college access, right. and they all have college access programs trying to get more students right. to attend college. And they come together now, everyone involved in recruiting and college access at all three higher ed institutions come together as a team. And their motto is refuse to duplicate.
Oh.
So if one of them, say UC Irvine, goes to a high school, they provide brochures and information on the other two institutions.
Oh,
and they
okay.
can talk about all three of them. And they've agreed their goal is to get more students attending college or university. And they
period.
Don't care
which one. It doesn't
matter
which one they go to, right.
Period.
So a bigger picture, a big picture view of education, getting students into college is important. And
That's right.
the individual college that they go to is less important than getting them in.
Absolutely. Right, and, so. And that kind of thinking just pervades how they work and much more efficient and much more powerful because the same message is going out to students.
You recently wrote a paper on your experiences working on the project in Ohio, which was interesting to me because it looks at the relationship between educational reform and economic reform in cities. So could you talk about that? You looked at some cases of what was going on in Ohio and how you use the term convergence to describe going up to another yeah. level of collaboration. Can you say something about that?
Well, this is really a big interest of mine now, and I guess I would put it this way, that there are really two big educational reform issues today that are connected. One that we've been talking about is typically referred to as the achievement gap. If you look at data from school districts across the country, roughly what you find is that students from low-income families perform about 20% worse on any measure that you can think of than students from affluent families. Mm-hmm. So that's called the achievement gap.
Right.
And that drives many of the social problems that we have in this country, and is certainly a tremendous threat to American democracy. And so everybody's trying to think, how do we better serve low-income students? How do we narrow that achievement gap? And I think a P16 approach is a very powerful way to do it. But now there's a second problem that people like Tony Wagner from Harvard and David Conley from Oregon have been describing as the global achievement gap, that we have to raise the academic skills of all students so that we're better able to compete in the 21st century economy and compete with our global competitors, many of whom are doing a much better job educating their students than we are. Ohio is a wonderful place to work on these issues, and I took the assignment really for two reasons. One, I was looking for a state that was committed to a P16 approach in terms of state policy, and Ohio is now one of the leading states in the country trying to, at the state level, integrate P16 with their higher ed system and bring those two systems into closer alignment. Also, Ohio and all of the Midwest has been hit even harder than Pennsylvania with the current economic, even before the recession. They've been hit very, very hard with the loss of auto plants, auto parts, manufacturing. So they're aware that they have to drastically raise the academic skills of students in order to compete, because many, many communities rested for decades on good jobs that only required a high school degree. And those days are over. And one of the things that I'm struck by is, and I've worked now in Ohio for 3.5 years, so I have been all over the state, that when I go to cities and communities and meet with the mayor and meet with the leaders, there is no nonsense discussion. Mm-hmm. They're very aware that their community may not survive for 20 years, in 20 years. And they've got to do something about it. And one of the important things about Ohio is a few years ago, they passed what they call the Ohio Core, which raised the academic standards and requirements for all high school students to graduate and began putting substantial money into this. Now, what I've been looking at is I sort of think of as the next stage of P16 reform, where communities are trying to connect their education reform efforts with the job training that they're doing and their economic development planning. Mm-hmm. And Ohio is a nice state because different parts of the state have different kind of problems. It's a very regional state, like as Pennsylvania is, and they're doing some very, very creative things to try to leverage as much as possible their educational efforts, again, with job training and integrated into their economic development planning. And they're starting to create the kinds of planning groups that bring people from each of these areas. Because again, what you typically find are silos. Mm-hmm. People in job training, they have very different funding streams, separate governance, reporting from the education people, from the economic development people. So it's another stage of collaboration when you bring all three of those networks together, get people talking about what's happening in their community.
Looking at the same economic data, the trends in the areas.
That's right. So one example, one of the very best collaboratives in the United States is Stark County, Ohio. Mm-hmm. And it's in the northwest portion of the state, Canton and its surrounding area. And they have been devastated by job loss because they have very heavy loss of good manufacturing and auto jobs and a very low average level of education, very low college going. So a group of leaders started what they call the Stark Educational Partnership. And what they've done is they've brokered conversations and brought together all of the school districts to look together at common issues, as well as local government, business, and all of the local funders and major community foundations to try to reach agreement on what can be done and direct resources toward it. Mm-hmm. So, and they've done several really important things. One is when you look P to 16, one of the things that really jumps out at you is, again, the typical low-income child begins school 18 months behind affluent children in school readiness. And whenever you pull together the data, and when I go into cities, I always have a PowerPoint presentation, that stops the crowd. in the past few years, there have been several major economic analyses of early childhood, the importance of early childhood education. And the best estimates that we have is that every dollar spent on early childhood education produces a 14 to 17% return in more graduates, more people employed, paying taxes, less crime, smaller prison populations,
so getting people
to
understand why that's important.
That's right.
Early on, and investing early on.
That's right.
Pays dividends.
So the Stark
later.
Partnership conducted that analysis, and then when there was agreement among the institutional leaders, brought together all of the early childhood providers in the state to do common planning and to maximize the number of students that they serve. They've also started a very, very successful campaign to encourage more youngsters to go to college. And they have they've brought together many people to work with families, provide information about college, information about application processes, financial aid, and they've had tremendous success with that as well. A second just quick example is the city of Dayton, which also was devastated with job loss, but they had one advantage, that they have a very, very large military base, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And a few years ago, the Congress went through a process and they closed a number of bases, but they not only kept Wright-Patterson open, but they expanded it. And in addition to being a military base, it's also the site for a great deal of military-related research in terms of new products and advanced ceramics and many things where I'm in the meeting. I don't understand what they're talking about, but it sounds like pretty advanced engineering.
Important things for science and technology.
And because the military has to buy from American producers, there are a number of small tech companies in the Dayton area. So the Dayton Educational Partnership brought all of these people together around a focus on science, technology, engineering, and math that goes from elementary school through the universities. And it's very, very exciting. And just to have an example of just how far they've gone on this. The first time I went there, I went to a meeting of a number of the representatives of the Educational Partnership. And the president of the Chamber of Commerce gave the speech on the importance of early childhood education, which is, you don't often find.
No.
But the business people understood.
They get it.
Return on investment.
Right.
They get it. And they've started a number of wonderful programs trying to infuse math and science into every educational level. They've raised a lot of money for professional development and training for math and science. Teachers, they've developed summer programs and experiences for students, and they're starting to get a tremendous payoff. And the goal is to have a much more educated and scientific and technologically skilled workforce to position themselves for the future. And it's a wonderful example of a city that really has reached consensus on that aim, that the survival of the city requires raising the educational skills of students, and the rising educational skills is key to the economic development strategy of the city. And they're marketing themselves nationally and internationally as a city that has an increasingly skilled workforce and the economic infrastructure that's needed.
And the skills that they're developing are tied in to the economic situation right in that area. And in addition, I would imagine that if you get people skilled, they don't necessarily leave to find employment. They're going to stay in the community. So you invested in educating members of the community. The jobs are going to be there when they're finished, and they're going to stay in the community because there are lots of benefits associated with the education
Absolutely.
That they got.
Absolutely.
So it really is a beautifully ecosystem right,
yes.
That everybody has come to see the benefit of starting early, choosing the skills that students are going to need to be competitive, looking at what the local economy actually needs and in terms of skills, and then working towards that.
Absolutely, and there's really a deep logic to all of that
yeah.
that people can finally see, but you need a group pulling together the data, honing the message, getting the message
right.
out to people, because that's really the situation of every city, mm-hmm. Including ours, but not all of them are able to make those connections and get the message out enough that there's agreement among people.
Right.
I mean, even in our own case, I don't think most people realize that a much higher percentage of our CCP graduates remain in the community
right.
than any other college or university
right.
In the city, and that we're a tremendous economic,
development
generator.
Right.
That's right.
Yeah, we're surrounded by wonderful institutions, but a lot of the institutions in Philadelphia attract students from all over the world, all over the country. But they don't necessarily stay in Philadelphia when they complete their education.
Right.
They go other places. So, valuable for while they're there. But how do we keep more well-educated persons in the city? And how do we help the educational level of the people who are committed to staying in Philadelphia? So, what are some new things that you're working on? I understand that you're working in terms of a high school in California now.
Yes. Well, after 3.5 years of traveling around Ohio, the gods have smiled on me.
Yeah, I went to school in Ohio.
Okay. It's a lovely state.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a lovely state. I've had wonderful meals in Cleveland, yes. I'm now working in Napa, California, and I've been engaged by the New Technology Foundation there. And that's also a very, very interesting project. The New Technology Foundation in Napa, California, is in the Napa Valley,
mm-hmm.
In Northern California, outside of San Francisco, where the
known for
wine,
the wine, right?
Right. So the Napa Valley school district has two high schools. One of which is called Vintage High School.
Oh.
I thought the other was going to be called Chardonnay, but no, it's called Napa High School.
That may be next.
Anyway, the New Technology Foundation was formed to support what's called New Tech High School, which is a wonderful, wonderful high school that's distinctive in that all teaching and learning is project and problem based.
Mm.
So all the classes in the high school are linked. Two teachers work together. They develop a series of projects. Every student is given a laptop, so you have what's called one-to-one computing. They have a technology support system, so the projects can be shared among the students and between the students and the teachers and others. And the idea of New Tech High School is to give students the experience of the 21st century workplace while in high school. So all the students work in teams. It's all one-to-one computing. It's all project-based.
Wow.
So all of the traditional subjects are integrated into real projects that the students are doing. Each team has to vote for its leaders.
Oh.
And I've discovered you can be voted off the island.
Oh, really?
if a student is not doing his or her work, the teachers urge the student team, they try to engage the student, but if the student won't do his or her work, the team can vote them off.
Oh my goodness.
And they have to work on their own.
Oh.
So they learn to
cooperate
with others, to communicate, to do things together. Then at the end of each project cycle, parents and other members of the community are brought in and the students make public presentations of their work. So they really learn all of the kind of 21st century work skills. They're learning literacy and math and science, but they're also learning cooperation and communication and teamwork and presentation skills. Mm. Now, this has really been a highly successful school. It started as a charter. It's now open to all students by lottery, so they're not just taking the best students, and parents are clamoring, and everybody's hoping,
right,
you know, for that day that the lottery results come out. A few years ago, the Gates Foundation, which in recent years has been heavily supporting the development of small schools and breaking big high schools into smaller houses or units, became aware of New Tech and put a good deal of money into it. And they now have a network of New Tech-like high schools around the country, right, which are also very, very successful. Mm. But after analyzing it, again, you've got that problem that you raised earlier. How do you bring reform to scale?
Right.
And even a wonderful boutique high school only has a small effect in a large district.
Right.
So the new initiative that they're trying and that they've brought me into the process to assist them with is they're trying to integrate the New Tech high school approach into their traditional pre-existing
schools,
large high
mm-hmm.
schools.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm studying that process of trying to implement it, because the school district is on to the problem. The superintendent, in fact, literally said to me, if a student graduates from our high schools with all A's, they're still not fully prepared for the world of the 21st century,
right,
because we're not demanding enough of them.
Mm.
And they're certainly not developing the skills of teamwork and cooperation and communication.
Right.
So the school board has passed a resolution that one of their goals is to transform the Napa School District into 21st century schools. And this New Tech approach is to be one of the ways to do that. So I'm looking at both how they develop these linked project-based classes within the high school, but also I'm helping them develop a model of how to use that experience to draw in more of the teachers, more of the administrators, to build public community support for it, to inform the parents, so that the New Tech approach becomes more and more the model of what mm-hmm. goes on in all the classes.
Mm-hmm.
And they're in the very early stages of it. They finished their first year of the project, and I'm right now writing up a report on it and trying to develop an assessment model for them so that they can track the degree of success they're having, mm-hmm. Affecting more and more of these entire comprehensive high schools.
Are they looking at all about the next step up when these students go to college and they've had experiences working on real projects, on a team, learning how to do to communicate? They're used to working with faculty who work in a collaborative way, and then they go to the traditional college that might not operate that way. Is the community thinking at all about, now I'm sure their students may go all over, but are they thinking for students that stay in the community, how do you get the colleges engaged in doing that same kind of approach if it's successful?
Well, you are now also thinking PD
right.
16.
unfortunately,
they have their heads down at okay. this moment, just trying to make things work
okay. at
in
the high
their
school
schools.
Level.
But you know, one of my tasks is to get their heads up
mm-hmm.
and to start thinking about that and engaging other institutions. Fortunately, they have in their community Napa Community College is one of the top community colleges in the entire mm. state, with some very progressive leadership. So I think it'll be easy
to bring them
in as a partner.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we've talked about the PD16 thinking, about collaboration and convergence, scaling things up, an innovative new high school model. If you had a chance to sit down with our governor in Pennsylvania to say, based on everything that I've learned and looked at over these many years that I've been involved in P16 thinking, economic development, what would you say we need to be thinking about right now in Pennsylvania? What would you say to the governor if you had a chance?
Well, I guess I would try to find a very polite way to say that the state needs to catch up with the leading states in the country on P16, because a number of others, Florida, Georgia, Indiana, Ohio, are far ahead of us mm-hmm. in terms of state policy, trying to connect K-12 with higher education and to do some joint planning. Mm-hmm. I mean, just for example, in the early days of the P16 approach, when people started looking at state policy, we discovered that in most states, including our own, the state high school exit requirements are not connected in any way to the 4-year college and university entrance requirements. The curricula in many school districts are not connected to the college prep requirements for 4-year institutions. Right. So many states are far ahead of us in doing that work, and it's really, really critical. Because, just as an example, fewer than 30% of low-income students are in a core college prep curriculum, which is why so many of them either don't go to college or struggle requiring remediation. And that kind of state policy can really help everyone if we start thinking about what needs to be done, how do we get disciplined dialogues of community college and university faculty talking with high school and middle school teachers. A lot of that work is much more advanced in other states. Mm-hmm. Also, one of the last things I was working on in the state of Ohio, which would also be valuable to us, is the Knowledge Works Foundation's initiative was designed to make sure that there were P16 councils in every county or at least region of the state of Ohio. And now that's pretty much up and running. Some of them are much more advanced, some of them are new, but they're working pretty much everywhere throughout the state. Mm. But so the next level of issue, which would be also an important issue for our state, is I was working on trying to broker ways to ensure that good ideas and good programs that were being developed at the local level would influence state policy so that the state decision makers would be in regular conversation with the local P16 councils where the action really is and give them a more direct tie to making policy. Because really the key for all states now is innovation. Right. How do we get the best new ideas developed and implemented? And they're generally the best innovation is generally gonna come from the people actually doing the work. In most states, those connections have not been built, and they're starting to develop in Ohio. And again, I think our state is behind places like Ohio and Indiana with their education P16 roundtable and some of the other states that have been at this longer.
So we really need to focus more attention on turning ourselves into P16 thinkers, bringing stakeholders together, and some of that can be done through state policy.
Absolutely. And I guess the last thing I would say is people often don't realize the absolute critical role of community colleges, because they are, in my research, the term I use is community colleges are really the nexus institution, because they typically work both down toward with school districts and K-12, and also work on transfer issues with 4-year colleges and universities. And states need to focus much more on our institutions and the role that we can play, because community colleges are situated to do things that really no other institution can do as well.
Right, particularly with the numbers of students that come in through our doors. It really is. And as you were saying, at community colleges, most of the students stay in the community. So you really are providing an education that's going to have an impact immediately, locally, if you're successful.
So. Absolutely.
Well, this has been an incredible conversation. I have learned a lot about what's going on around the country and about the role you've played in helping people think through how to collaborate, how to work together, and what we could be doing next, both as an institution, I think, and as a city and as a state. So thank you very much, Dennis. I really appreciated your coming
pleasure.
In.
My pleasure. Thank you.